Good morning, AUPNs. Good morning. How was your sleep last night? Oops. Okay. Good morning, Glenn.
Good morning, Aran.
How are you?
I'm fine. Okay. How about our students in AUP? How are you, AUP? Huh? How are you?
What again? Good. Okay, let's have this response again. Do you remember what we have taught you? When I say heirs of God, you will say we are. And when I say we are, you will say heirs of God. Can we do that again? Okay. Heirs of God.
We are.
We are. Amen. Amen.
Let's try to give them a new handshake.
Okay, let's teach them a new handshake.
Okay, let's follow us. The Touching Lives already know this handshake.
Yes.
Okay, but for the rest, okay, we will be teaching you about another handshake for this week of prayer. Mm. Okay, Ariel?
Okay, this is how you do this, okay?
Of course, you cannot do a handshake by yourself. So find a partner.
Find a partner.
Find a partner.
Your seatmate or the person in your back.
Let's move. Find your partner, okay?
Okay.
Have you already find your partner? Okay, let's try.
Okay, this is how you do it. God loves you.
Okay. Well, come on, let's try to see them.
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's share it to our friends.
Okay. With matching smile.
Huh? Yes, with matching smile.
Okay, let's do this. Once again, okay?
Once again, okay. Ready?
Ready?
Go.
Go.
God loves you.
Okay? God loves you.
Okay.
Now we would like to welcome you once again for the first day of our week of prayer. Mm-hmm. And we are moving now to the seventh lesson that we will be hearing from our dear speakers. Well, yesterday it seems that the topic is, you know, it's timely message for us. Okay, the title of the topic is Breaking the Chains of Sin. Okay, and you know, what I have learned yesterday seems that no one can break that chain except through Jesus Christ.
Amen. Okay?
Only His truth can set us free. And most of us have learned that only Jesus can break that chain.
Yes, you know, last night, dear friends, I have a fever, a flu. And when I realized that I am having a flu, I go to God and humbly come to Him and pray and ask for forgiveness. Because one thing, when we have sickness or fever, it is the chain that entangled us with sin. And when we go to God, when we repent humbly to Him in prayer, He will indeed faithfully forgive us. Just like now, I am much better, feeling much better. And even though I have a little fever, I still praise God for releasing that chain from me.
It seems that it's true that neither sickness nor death can separate us with the love of God.
Amen.
Okay, so now we would like to welcome once again every one of you to our week of prayer. So what is the topic all about this morning?
Okay. So our topic this morning starts with the letter F. That means something that symbolizes the sister or brother next to you.
It's about friendship.
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 Yes. So we will not only be talking about our earthly friend, but also our friend in heaven, the best friend that we can ever had. So yeah, I praise God. You know, when I was sick last night again, there are these friends of mine that visited me, and they reminded me of the love of Jesus through these friends. And I praise God that one day, this same God we are serving is the same friend we will see in the clouds of heaven.
Yeah.
Amen.
So today we will not only talk about Daniel and his friends, but then we will be seeing our dear best friend, which is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
It seems that to start our week of prayer, we'd like to invite everyone to once again focus on the message that we will be hearing from our speaker. And We would like to remind you that all the things that we are doing in this place is all about worship. So please focus your hearts and minds and let the Holy Spirit rule our hearts and minds so that we can digest, we can understand the messages that we will be hearing for this morning. I would like to share to you Psalms 96, verses 7 to 13. It says here, "Give unto the Lord, O ye kindreds of the people. Give unto the Lord glory and strength. Give unto the Lord the glory due unto his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. O worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Fear before him all the earth. Say among the heathen that the Lord reigneth. The world also shall be established, that it shall not be moved. He shall judge the people righteously. Let the heavens rejoice, and let the earth be glad. Let the sea roar, and the fullness thereof. Let the field be joyful, and all that is therein. Then shall all the trees of the wood rejoice before the Lord, for he cometh to judge the earth. He shall judge the world with righteousness and the people with his truth."
Once again, as we get to worship this morning, let's get to know more about our royal friend. Good morning, heirs of God.
Shall we all rise and sing our theme song, Into God's Family?
Into God's family we now reside. Into God's family His love will abide. Looking to Jesus, our comfort and home, waiting and watching for Christ's soon return. Led by His Spirit, we're heirs of God. Brothers and sisters through Jesus' blood, living united in truth and love, we're sharing the blessings from God above. Into God's family we now reside. Into God's family His love will abide. Looking to Jesus, our comfort and home, waiting and watching for Christ's soon return. A family that prays in togetherness, sure of Christ's guidance and happiness. The home that stays true is God's delight. Committed as one, we will share the light. Into God's family we now reside. Into God's family His love will abide. Looking to Jesus, our comfort and home, waiting and watching for Christ's soon return. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Joined hands with Jesus as we travel this world, for I'm part of the family. worthy, the family of God, for I'm part of the family.
Good day, everyone. For this morning, the prayer focus is all about our personal relationship with God. And for our thoughts of prayer, God is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. Not those who seek merely His blessings, but those who seek Him are the ones who find their reward, for He is the reward. If this is true, then true faith is more interested in seeking than giving, than in seeking the gifts. So, for the sequence of our season of prayer, as we kneel down, the song leaders will be singing a song to tune up our hearts. Then next, the congregation will be given 3 minutes for them to pray. After that, a song will be sung once more to indicate that the time is up. And lastly, would be the concluding prayer by Sir R.D. Tayongtong. So we would like to invite the congregation to pray by twos. So shall we all kneel?
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Father, you just heard our prayers and requests. I pray, Heavenly Father, that whatever hinders you from answering all of this, I pray that you will entune our hearts so as we continue to enjoy your gift of prayer, our thoughts will be more aligned to the plans you have set before us. Invoke our hearts, Heavenly Father, to struggle for that one personal relationship with you, only for the reason that we love you as our God, Creator, Savior, and Guide. This I pray. Amen.
Good morning, PIC. How many of you here is happy that tomorrow is Friday? Can I see a raise of hands? Yes, how many of you are happy that it's the weekend tomorrow? Now, most of all, how many of you here is delighted and happy that we are once again in the house of the Lord, ready to hear what He has to say for us? Amen. Let us bow our heads for a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, here we are, your children. We're here in your house of worship, ready to listen to what you have to say to us. Oh Lord, I pray that you would cleanse us, open our hearts and our minds, that we may understand the words you want us to hear. Oh Lord, please be with me, your humble servant, that I may say only words that will be from you. Please be with us, Lord, throughout this whole week of prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Throughout the week, we have heard the word of God on family. Family issues, issues that happen within the family, issues towards authority, and towards a mother, a father. And I know all of you have noticed a pattern here. Look at our wonderful decoration. The decoration committee has done a great job. They have added bits and pieces every day, a mother, a father, Jesus, and we have all seen that. I was telling my friend a while ago that with this palace behind me, I feel very underdressed because I think that I should be wearing a gown and a crown just to fit this palace, but no need to worry because once we will be wearing these beautiful garments, once we claim our inheritance as heirs of the kingdom of the Lord. Amen? Now, my job this morning is to give you a little bit of a segue. Let us divert our attention from the usual family setting, which is the mother, the father, the son, and or the daughter. But before that, let's go back to the basics. Here? Let us define the word heir. There are three top definitions of the word heir that I will be mentioning, and let's see which one of these three fit in. First is, an heir is a person who will be receiving money from another person. That's a bit far from what we'll be talking about. The next is, an heir is a person who acquires property from another person, of course. It's the rules of descent and distribution, namely being the child and descendant or another closest relative of the dear departed. Well, of course, property as well won't be discussed this morning. And the last and the third is the continuation of a legacy. An heir or a person inheriting and continuing the legacy of a predecessor. Now, the definition of the word heir that we will be using this morning is the third one. A person passing on a legacy that has been inherited to us and a legacy that is to be continued. Now the question is, how does one person become an heir? How do I get this legacy that my forefathers have? Most importantly, what is this legacy. I need your help, all of you. Can any one of you please give me a name, okay? A name of a character in the Bible. If you know this name, please don't spoil it for the others. If you know a person who was a Hebrew, a character in the Bible, I want to hear your guesses, okay? The next is, his name is a book in the Old Testament. A little bit vague, okay? The third is, he was a very prayerful man. Anyone? Okay, number four, he was very good at dream interpretation. Okay, the last, he had three friends, namely Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Yes, Daniel, very good. We now have the main man of this morning, Daniel. And we know now that an heir, or sa Tagalog, tagapagmana, is a person that will be continuing a legacy of someone that came before him. Now let's connect heir and Daniel. What did Daniel inherit? Can all of you raise up your Bibles or your cell phones, your iPads? Can I see them? Thank you very much. Please open these beautiful books with me to Daniel chapter 1, verse 1. I will be reading from the New International Version. It says that in Daniel chapter 1, verse 1, in the third year of the reign of King Jehoiakim of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. Now let's start to get to know our main character. When King Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, took Jerusalem, made its people captives, Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, his three friends, were part of it. They lost their families, unfortunately, during the captivity. And so, in result, they were now orphans. The act of inheriting something, or inheritance, usually and mostly comes from your closest relatives, which are your family, your parents. Now, what was the same thing that Daniel inherited from his parents that his friends inherited as well? They inherited their parents' faithfulness in God. Now, let me give you a little bit of a background here. What Daniel and his friends inherited from their parents was the legacy of faithfulness to God. Now, Filipinos, we all know that Filipinos are very hospitable people. They're very family-oriented. Well, the Hebrew people as well were very family-oriented, and they had this command from God to pass on this faithfulness, this legacy, on to their children. In Deuteronomy 6, verses 4 to 9, please open your Bibles with me. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. We all know this. Love the Lord your God with what? All your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. This is the command that God gave Israel, to keep these words in their hearts, to commit them to memory and make them a very important part of their lives. Now let's go a little bit back to Deuteronomy 6, chapter 6, verse 2. It says, and that you may so revere the Lord your God that you will keep all his statutes, his commandments, that I am giving you, your children, and your grandchildren, all your lives, to prolong your days. Now there you have it. The Lord has commands and He has given the responsibility that He has instructed us to follow, not just to the Israelite people back then, but to their, to Himself, their children, and of course, their grandchildren, and the list goes on and on. The faith of the fathers and the reverence for God was the purpose of these verses. They should teach this reverence and pass it on to the next generation. Now let's go back to the main man, Daniel. His book in the Bible is full of trials and adventures that if it weren't Daniel himself who experienced them, it was his friends. Now, what did Daniel experience? His experience was he was thrown. Where was he thrown? Into the lion's den, yes. He was thrown into the lion's den. Why? Because he was being too prayerful to the God up above and not praying to the king. Now, his friends also had a trial. They were also thrown. There's a lot of throwing going on here. Well, they were also thrown into the fiery furnace this time. But then, let's look into one more story that Daniel experienced with his friends with him this time. Turn with me again to Daniel chapter 1, verse 3, and onwards. In verse 3 and 4 of chapter 1, I know that all of you know this story. King Nebuchadnezzar commands his chief official, the name is Ashpenaz, he said, Ashpenaz, I want you to go to the Israelite men that we captured and get men that had no physical defect, that were very handsome, ladies, that were well-versed in all kinds of wisdom, and that were well-educated, that understood quickly, and of course, qualified to serve in the king's palace. Now, Daniel and his friends all qualified to the qualifications given by the king, and in result to that, they were brought to the king's palace. Jumping to verse 8, Daniel and his friends experienced a trial. What was this challenge? It was drinking wine and eating from the king's table. Now, we all know how the story goes. Daniel and his friends don't want to eat from the king's table because they know that the wine and the food on the king's table are unhealthy. So what they do, they ask Ashpenaz, Ashpenaz, we will eat our own healthy food. And then Ashpenaz says, okay, but at the end of this 10-day period, you have to come back. So this 10-day period went on, morning, noon, and nighttime, they ate their own healthy food, fruits, vegetables, grains. And at that end of the 10 period, they went back to the palace. They showed themselves in front of Ashpenaz again. All of the Israelite men that were chosen and that were qualified were brought together again at the king's palace. And Ashpenaz said, wow, Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, look at you. You're way more healthier, way more well-nourished, you're way more handsome than all of these other men that ate from the king's table and drank their wine. Now, what result do we see here? Daniel and his three friends all stood for what was right. And where did they get this rightness, or where did they get this right thing from? The legacy, where did they get it from? They got it from their parents, of course. And what happened in return when they did what was right? God honored these four friends' friendship. In Daniel 1, verse 17, it says that to these four young men, God gave knowledge and understanding of all kinds of literature and learning. And Daniel could understand visions and dreams of all kind. God himself blessed and he advanced these four young men. He blessed them and he advanced them in the foreign court. In Daniel 2, verse 47, the king said to Daniel, surely your God is the God of gods and the Lord of kings, and a revealer of mysteries, for you were able to reveal this mystery. This is the king talking right after Daniel interpreted his dream. You know, because the four friends stood for what was right, they stood firm on what they believed in, and they proved that the legacy of the faith that was passed on to them and the trust in the Lord, that they will be delivered under any circumstance, being it thrown in the lion's den or thrown in the fiery furnace. Everything that they did displayed the Lord's power to the nations. Through them and their friendship, God was to be glorified. Amen? Now, let's go on to the practical side. I know that all of you here have been in an argument, in a fight. Now, in my recent argument, well, not really recent, but in the last argument that I had, this person that I was having an argument with told me that before you point your finger at someone else, why don't you look at yourself? Look at yourself first before pointing the blame at anyone else. Now, we won't be pointing fingers today, but I would like you to dwell on this question. Before pointing your finger, look at yourself. How do I become a right friend? Now, how do I become a Daniel to my friends? Why look at others first when we ourselves haven't looked in us? There are three points that I would like to share. The first is, examine yourself. On what basis are you a true friend? What is a true friend, anyway? Well, that leads us straight to point number two. It's on the screen. Stick to the right principles. There are so-called right paths and wrong paths. Friends have the same likes. If not likes, there is this saying also that says, opposites attract. Now, if friends have the same like and opposites attract, why is it? Well, maybe it's because, hey, look at what she's doing. I don't see that in AUP. I want to try that. Or, look at that drink in that guy's hand. Look at it. He looks so cool holding that drink, you know? I want to try that. You know, my friends, curiosity may lead us downhill. In the Ministry of Healing, page 469, it says that it is through the social relations that Christianity comes in contact with the world. Every man or woman who has received the divine illumination is to shed light on the dark pathway of those who are unacquainted with a better way. I want to stress this first sentence. Let's go back. It is through the social relations that Christianity comes in contact with the world. You know what? The best thing that you can do is to be an example. Be an example to your friends. We all know that it's hard to be called the killjoy sa tropa, KJ ka naman, or that person who wouldn't want to try new things. But think of what your friends will be thinking about when they see yourself sticking to our second point, which is sticking to the right principles. Now, be a friend. Be a right friend. That through you and everyone you come in contact with, we will be one step closer to our Lord Jesus Christ. Don't you want that? Imagine sitting in heaven under the tree, let's say a tree, and you look around, admiring all the beautiful creatures and everything that God has prepared for you, and you look beside you, and then you see that your friends are sitting beside you, and you're telling stories just like the old times. Don't you want that? Now, the last point is, okay. The last point is loyalty to the relationship or loyalty to the friendship. Now, when your friends are in need, When your friends are in need, would you pray for them? When your friends have failing grades, do we keep encouraging them? Do we show concern? Do we show that we care? Do we listen to them, to all their stories? Do we listen to them? Do we do our part in the relationship? Now, ladies, I would like to ask you a question because I do not know how it is with the men. Ladies, imagine yourself sitting at, let's say, the College of Business or the College of Theology, and then you see this guy. He's walking down the hallway. Then you think, wow, this guy is so cute. Now, who do you text first? Be honest, who do you text first? You have yourself in your hand, you see this cute guy, who do you text first? Your friends, your best friends. Okay, I don't know how it is with guys, so. Okay, so why do you tell your friends? Why do you tell them that there's this cute guy coming your direction? You know that he doesn't see you. Why do you tell them? Well, the point is because we want to share that same excitement. We want to tell them everything. We want to tell our friends everything. Now, why? Because we want them to feel the same excitement that we have just experienced. We want their advice, and we want their concern, and we want them to listen to us. If you see that, hey, oh nga no, my friend is doing that for me. She listens to all my stories. She's always there for me. Or he's always there for me. But the question is, do you or are you always there for him or her? Do you do your part in the friendship? Dare to be a Daniel. Dare to stand for what is right. Dare to pray for your friends when you aren't together, even though it means that you will be thrown into the lion's den or thrown in the fiery furnace. Dare to be thankful for your relationships. Dare to be a Daniel. We have now examined ourselves. We have looked at ourselves. Let's move on to the choosing of the right friends. Who among you have a friend that knocks on your door, walks in, hi friend, and then walks straight to your refrigerator, opens it, and then eats or drinks everything that is in it? Well, not really everything, but helps himself or herself. Or do you have this friend that walks straight into your house, of course, ask permission from your parents, of course, and walks straight into your bedroom and sits herself or lies down on your bed, not asking permission from you? Wow, a lot of you can relate. Now, there's this verse in Proverbs 18, verse 24. A man of many friends will come to ruin, but there is a friend who sticks closer than a brother. A friend that sticks closer than a brother. There are certain friends that you can call family. Am I right? Yes. You know, there is a key to having loyal friends or making friends in the first place. You have to be careful of who you choose. Speaking about making and choosing friends, I have a story. I was born in a country called Palau. It's a beautiful country in the islands of Micronesia. And after years of my parents teaching there, they decided that we should move back here to the Philippines for good. So that's what we did. We moved in 2003, and I was 8 years old back then. One afternoon, I was having a nap, and then my mom comes into my room. She says, "Gay, there are these two girls outside. They're our neighbors. Why don't you wake up and make friends with them?" I was like, "Mom, why do you wake a child up from her afternoon nap?" Of course, I didn't tell her that. But, you know, who wakes a child up from her afternoon nap? Anyway, I think she was concerned with my social life. So what I did, I got up, I stood up, and I waited for my mom to bring these two girls into my room. So they were brought into my room, And I tell you, I was not in the best mood, because who wakes a person up to make friends? Anyway, so these two girls, I started to talk to them. I started to make friends. What's your name? You know, how children talk. And I noticed that there was this problem. I noticed that we couldn't understand each other. Why? Because I wasn't fluent in Tagalog back then. And these two girls weren't fluent as well in English. So what I did, I asked these two girls. I asked the younger one. She was about my age. A bit older, but she was about my age. I asked her, do you want to read a book? She didn't answer. I was like, and I threw the book at her, having this bad mood and all. Anyway, I would like to say sorry again, even though we joke about it all the time. Don't worry, I don't make friends and throw books at the same time anymore. So this friend of mine that I threw the book at, she's still my friend. And I can treat her as family as well. Now tell me who your friends are, and I will tell you who you are. A person becomes more like those that they are with, which is why it is important to choose your friends wisely. God gives us a warning in Proverbs 13, verse 20. He who walks with the wise grows wise, but a companion of fools suffers harm. It is proven that in psychology, you are what you eat. This is not literal, of course. Well, bad company corrupts good morals almost every time. Most often, we become like those we associate with. Am I right? Now, there are benefits when you choose your friends carefully. In a US study, researchers measured the happiness of 4,739 people within a 20-year interval. The study found that a person's happiness depends on the people that they connect with. Dr. Tupi Luft, a psychologist in Penticton, British Columbia, says that people with more supportive friends are less likely to develop depression and anxiety. Though you can't choose your family or your work colleagues for the faculty, you do have your control over friendship. If you want an environment where you can always turn to trusted people left and right, and people that you can call your friends, choose wisely. The Bible teaches us what a true friend is. A true friend, in Proverbs 12:26, is a righteous person will seek out his neighbor, but the way of the wicked will lead them astray. What does this verse tell us? Proverbs 12:26, a righteous person will seek out his neighbor, but the way of the wicked will lead them astray. It says that a true friend shows concern. In Proverbs 27, verses 5 and 6, what is a true friend? Before a rebuke that is open, better a rebuke that is open than a love that is hidden. The wounds of a friend mean well, but the kisses of an enemy are profane. In Proverbs 27, 5 and 6, it says that a true friend will not talk behind your back. He or she will tell you right in front of your face what you are doing wrong. For me, a true friend is family. Why family? Because family is supposed to be there for you all the time. Family will always be there for you, even though you push them away. Well, true friends have the same characteristics as well as family. A true friend would never want to lead you astray. A true friend will listen to all your love life stories, to all your heartbreaks, to all your stories about how your boss is being too hard on you and how your classmates don't talk to you, you know, a true friend will always listen to you without tire, just like family would. A true and faithful friend will tell you straight up what you are doing wrong. Why? Because just like family, a true friend cares about you. I have this letter. I received this letter. It's not with me right now, but I received this letter from one of my closest friends. We became friends in elementary school, and so we move on to high school. Unfortunately, in high school, we didn't talk that much because we were separated in different sections. But during the second year of high school, I went out of my classroom because it was break time, and I saw her. So we talked, and then we got to catch up a little bit. But I think that during that little chat, she noticed something that wasn't part of the old Kiari before. So we ended our talk, goodbye, because the bell rang. So we went back to our classrooms. After the last period in the afternoon, I saw her again. She handed me this letter, and we said our goodbyes. And when I went home, I read this letter. I cannot forget the sentences, these two sentences that have always been stuck in my mind. These two sentences said, "Kaya, kahit hindi na tayo masyadong nagkakasama, sana hindi ka magbabago. Nandito lang ako para sa'yo." Or in English, "Kaya, even though we don't see each other that much, I hope that you won't change. I'm always here for you." You know, this person showed me concern. She showed me that she cared. She showed me that she was family. By those simple sentences in her letter, she showed me that I had a true friend. We have gotten to know Daniel, his friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and how they stood up for what was right. This is what they were taught at home. This was a legacy that was passed on to them. Now, Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego all have claimed the legacy that was passed on to them, the legacy of the faith. We have also looked at ourselves, examined ourselves, and saw if it was true friendship that we have to offer to our friends. We have also enumerated the things concerning of what a true and right friend really is. But I want you now to picture this. Imagine with me. Imagine four young men, four men about our age, around 18 to 20, four young men, orphans, walking down the dusty road from Jerusalem, this place that was once their home, thinking of what will happen next to us. What will happen next? We have lost our home, our family. Imagine thinking that your home is now gone, and all you have left are these three other young men beside you, walking the same way, thinking about the same things. You see, in Daniel's case, he didn't have family anymore. He was an orphan just like his other three friends. I know that some of us in this beautiful house of worship also feel orphaned. Some of us right now feel that you don't have anyone to turn to. But friends, look around you. Look at the people beside you. Well, if they're not beside you, look around you. You have your friends. Friends that you can call family when no one else is there for you. You know what can cheer you up more? Please open your Bibles to the book of John. John chapter 15, verses 13 and 16. 13 and 16. Now, whenever you need a friend, you can turn to these verses. No one has greater love than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. Then the Father will give you everything you ask in my name. Isn't that wonderful? Jesus Christ, a friend that is willing to lay down his life just for you because he loves you. He has been knocking on your door. Friend, open the door. I'm here for you. This divine being wants to be your friend. A friend that you did not choose, but that chose you. A friend that you can tell everything to. A friend that will care for you when you push him away countless of times. A friend that will never abandon you when you are thrown in the lion's den or in a fiery furnace. Now, to remind us that Jesus wants to be our friend, I want all of us to sing the fourth verse of Jesus is All the World to Me. Please sing with me. Jesus is all. You friends, value this friendship. Value the friendship of those people who care for you, and value the friendship of those people that you can call family. Now, what I want you to do right now is to lift up your cell phones. Cell phones, yes, you have been hiding them. Please lift them up. There. What is a better way to let these friends know than by telling them yourself? So if you're sitting beside them, I want you to tell them right now. Tell them thank you for being such a great friend. And if they aren't here, that's what your cell phones are for. I'll give you about 3 seconds or 5 seconds to text your friends. Tell them that you are beyond blessed to have a friend like them. There's a lot of hugging going on here in the ladies section. Okay. Now, I want you to remember that Jesus will always be there for you. He will always be your friend. He will always be your family, no matter how much you push him away. As we listen to the appeal song, let us contemplate on how blessed we are that within your friends, within these people around you, you have found family. Just like Daniel. That when he lost his home and his parents, he still had his friends.
Work in your life. He to enter your heart. Come and be a part of His family, the family of God. Do you know how sweet to be in God's loving family? Oh, such fellowship to be in God's kingdom. Let us come and be a part of His family, the family of God. Jesus, we abide, and we worship side by side, joyful singing without end. Heavenly angels will attend. Let us love one another, and brother and sister. Come and be a part of His family, the family of God. Living for Jesus, abiding in His word, soon in heaven we'll be in the family of God. For when in Jesus we abide, and we worship side by side, joyful singing without end, heavenly angels will attend. Let us love one another, every brother and sister. Come and be a part of His family, the family of God. The family, the family of God.
I feel reassured. I feel reassured, don't you? That not only through our family, but through friends as well, that we can call our family, we will be one step more closer, one step closer to claiming our inheritance as heirs, heirs of God's wonderful heavenly kingdom. I want to remind you again that Jesus Christ Himself chose you. You did not choose Him. God chose you. But the question is, would you accept the friendship that He has to offer? How many of you will accept this friendship that Jesus Christ has to offer? Thank you. As we value the friends that we have here on this earth, we should also value the friendship with Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, our co-heir to our Heavenly Father's kingdom. Let us pray. We thank You, O Lord, for allowing us to hear Your message. We thank You, Lord, for these people, not only friends, but people that we can call as family. Lord, I pray that You would be with each and every one of us. Help us, Lord, to be a true friend. Help us, Lord, to choose our friends wisely, that through everyone that we come in contact with, we will be one step closer to claiming this heavenly kingdom that You have waited so long for us to claim. I pray, Lord, that You would always be in our hearts and in our minds. Lord Jesus, we love You. We want to open that door and receive your friendship. Receive the friendship. Thank you, Lord, for everything. And in Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
For when in Jesus we abide, and we worship side by side, joyful singing without end, heavenly angels will attend. Let us love one another, every brother and sister. Come and be a part of His family, the family of God. In the family, the family.